The Olive Tree Forum at City University principally is designed to give scholarships to Israeli and Palestinian students studying undergraduate degrees here at City. There's some blurb about it up on the screen, but if you really want to know how that program works in its most intense element, which is discussion between the parties on either side of that conflict, I invite you to go to the website of City University /olive tree. And as of tonight, amongst the videos of the various fora that we've had in the past year, you will come across a video that of a meeting that we had on the 8th of February where we tried to explain to a wider audience what it actually means to have a discussion between two communities who are in conflict and what it means for the people involved. So much for the commercial. This evening, the intention is to look in a reflective way on how the media covered the Arab revolts in 2011. And we are really honored to have such a sterling panel to do this. We had to change the venue to accommodate all of you. And while one of those star celebrities gathers his breath, Zahra Harb, Dr. Harb, is both a journalist and a new academic appointment at City University, senior lecturer in international journalism. And she's covered war from the Lebanese vantage point. She's written about it and what that means. And she was monitoring Arab coverage of the Arab revolts throughout last year. And she's going to give us her thoughts, just 10 minutes. That's all we're asking of our speakers in the first instance, on what she thought about that Arab coverage. And then we move to Jeremy and then to John.
Shall I start? I hope I can cover it in 10 minutes. So the question I will be addressing tonight is how did Arab media cover the Arab revolts, which could be easily addressed if we are investigating state-controlled media coverage. And the straightforward answer would be dominant narratives of total denial of what was happening on the streets, focus on the capability and ability of the leader, and accusations of foreign conspiracy. In short, total hypocrisy. In Tunisia, a country where the government historically kept tight control on the media, where almost no platform was available for opinions critical of the political elite, state media demonstrated systematic and organized silence, placing a blackout about the uprising and the protests. During the first 2 weeks of the Tunisian revolution, the Tunisian main broadcaster, TVSAT, completely steered away from mentioning news about Mohamed Bouazizi, the university graduates who self-immolated, and the subsequent deaths of targeted civilians. They later started a campaign of demonizing the protesters as thugs and outlaws. In Egypt, similar narratives and approaches were repeated. Mahmoud Saad, one of the main hosts on the famous popular Egyptian TV show Al Bayt Baytak, revealed that he was asked by the information minister at the time, Anas El Faqi, not to mention what was happening in Tunisia because, as he said, Tunisia is different than Egypt. Later, when the protests started, Saad was asked to say that the protesters in Egypt were young youth with no destructive aims, but was later hijacked by the destructive youth of the Muslim Brotherhood. Saad resigned in the mid of the Egyptian revolution, as did Egyptian TV news anchor Shahira Amin, who joined the demonstrators in Tahrir and sent a text message to her boss informing him that she resigns and that she is standing by the people of Tahrir and not with the brutal regime that he is covering up for. Suhan Naqash, another Egyptian state-run TV news anchor, admitted that she was used as a tool to lie to the people. She said the worst phrase she was asked to repeat every hour on the hour on Egyptian TV and will never forget was, "Calm has been restored in the streets of Cairo." while millions were still protesting and being attacked either by the police or by what was known later as Baltajiye, most secret police in civilian clothes. Exclusive lies are exclusive to Egyptian TV, one of the slogans that protesters carried during demonstrations summarized the national media scene in Egypt at the time. In Libya, one example would sum up the reality of the Libyan TV. A news presenter was featured educating her audiences that the United Nations adoption of the no-fly zone is haram, forbidden, and against the teaching of Islam, as adoption is haram, forbidden in Islam. And that was her interpretation of what the word adoption means. The total blockout of information the state media in these countries were practicing has led activists and journalists to seek and take refuge in other media platforms with the aim of revealing that the state-run media was hiding or manipulating. They found virtual spaces where they can express their opinion and fulfill their democratic aspirations in bringing about freedom, freedom of speech, and political freedom and change. Facebook, Twitter, and YouTube have become political spaces that helped activists to disseminate common knowledge about the regime's systematic approach to suppress and oppress their citizens, spreading and sharing common knowledge about the brutality of those regimes and the ability to defy them has facilitated common beliefs of that ability, which in turn facilitated the common action of protesting and more protesting. Speak to Tunisian journalists and activists, and they tell you stories and stories of how they utilized Facebook and YouTube. Speak to Egyptian journalists and activists, and they in turn will tell you about YouTube, Facebook, and Twitter. For those activists and journalists, the political spaces social media provided helped them tell their stories and their fellow protesters' stories as they were unfolding. The question to ask here, if stories of these revolutions were mostly narrated via social networks, what role did the Arab satellite channels play during those revolts then? As many of you might know, the Arab world witnessed an influx of satellite channels during the 1990s and in the early years of the first decades of the new century. Many analysts in the Arab world applauded this influx as a potential tool for political change in the Arab countries. Two stations were at the heart of the new optimism, Al Jazeera and Al Arabiya, the two most prominent 24-hour news channels in the region. Al Jazeera proved to be more controversial because in its early years of broadcasting, it managed to break taboos in the Arab media by tackling issues of human rights and hosting Arab dissidents. Also, its coverage of international conflicts, primarily Afghanistan and Iraq, has marked it as a counter-hegemonic news outlet. For the first time, the flow of news went from south to north. Some scholars who study Arab satellite media and Al Jazeera specifically have gone so far as to suggest that it has created a new Arab public sphere. However, the recent political developments in the Arab world, mainly the revolutions in Bahrain and Syria, have raised questions as to how credible these suggestions are. It would be wrong to suggest that Arab satellite channels have been totally redundant in the revolutionary process. Throughout the Tunisian and Egyptian revolutions, Al Jazeera became a disseminating tool for user-generated content. A call for Arab citizens to send their footage of unfolding events to Al Jazeera website for it to rebroadcast on its TV screens was a key factor in the dissemination of what was happening. However, the role Al Jazeera played in supporting the Egyptian revolution in specific, which caused some Arab analysts to give it the name Channel of Revolutions, was quickly followed by criticism for their lack of coverage of the pro-democracy protests in Bahrain. The killing of peaceful protesters in Bahrain did not get airtime the way that the killing of Egyptian pro-democracy protesters had. Tweets, Facebook posts, and comments came pouring in, questioning the lack of coverage from Bahrain. Al Arabiya followed Al Jazeera's lead. Bahrain was put last on the running order of the coverage of the Arab revolutions. Newspaper articles across the Arab world were questioning the absence of the opinion and other opinion, Al Jazeera's Arabic motto, when it came to Bahrain. Al Jazeera's officials claimed that they did not actually deliberately been absent, but they had logistical problems within the coverage since Al Jazeera was banned in Bahrain. However, it can be argued that Al Jazeera was also banned in Egypt and Tunisia at the time of the revolutions, and that did not stop the channel from reporting or remodeling its screen to host rebroadcast and activist-generated content, and that is exactly what they are doing now in Syria. Al Jazeera's coverage of the Bahrain protest has been influenced by the Qatari foreign policy, and in the case of Bahrain, is arguably abiding by Qatar's commitment to Gulf Cooperation Council security treaties. This has become one of the occasions when Al Arabiya and Al Jazeera appear to have shared the same editorial guidelines influenced by Qatari and Saudi Arabian shared policy. In summary, Bahrain protests were almost absent from Al Jazeera Arabic output. Here we have to make a clear distinction between Al Jazeera Arabic and Al Jazeera English. Al Jazeera Arabic coverage of the revolutions requires a separate in-depth study. There have been clear differences in the editorial policies between the two channels, and one of the reasons might have been their respective target audiences. The Arabic channel is abiding by the Qatar's foreign policy positions, and hence its coverage follows those positions closely, while Al Jazeera English seems to be more liberated from Qatar policy tendencies, and it might be that it largely addresses audiences away from the Arab land. Promoting the Qatari political agenda has proven to be evident in Al Jazeera coverage, not just in Bahrain, but also in covering the Syrian revolt. Al Jazeera Arabic has clearly become part of an all-out media war between a state-run media machine and an army of new media activists supported by Al Jazeera, and both sides are willing to sacrifice truth for the sake of achieving victory. Syrian revolt has produced conflicting narratives that no other Arab revolt has produced. Stories of what is happening on the ground are used by both sides and interpreted differently by different people. The Syrian government / regime has learned the media lessons from the Tunisian and Egyptian revolts and occupied its own space on social networks, supported by what is called the Syrian Electronic Army. In Syria, if you talk about imperialist American-Israeli plot conspiracy to destabilize Syria, it resonates with a large section of the Syrian population. The Syrian regime is propagating the pitfalls of the other Arab revolts, which in turn make religious minorities in Syria think twice before abandoning their supports to the regime. The opposition, on the other hand, is so desperate that it is making it easier for the state-controlled media to pick up on exaggerated stories, and sometimes stories that did not even take place, or fall for media traps that are planted by the pro-regime journalists and activists. The fighters/activists rush to post or publish stories before verifying the authenticity of such stories, which make it easier for the official media to hit on the credibility of the fighters/activists' messages. Both have planted moles at each other's camp, making it difficult to separate truth from fabrication and sometimes exaggeration, especially when it comes to casualties numbers. The only truth in Syria at the moment is that civilians are falling victims and abuses are taking place on both sides of the spectrum. Of course, there is no equal balance in there. And especially with the Human Rights Watch report that was issued yesterday on abuses practiced by factions in the opposition. Total hypocrisy and denial is still the main feature of the state-controlled media narrative in Syria, as was the narrative of the other fallen regimes in the Arab world. But in the case of Syria, the state narrative is regaining oxygen by the ill media performance of the Syrian opposition. Thank you.
Thank you. I think we now know, Zahra, why you belong both in journalism and in academia. That was a stupendous tour de raison of the situation on the Arab side. I know, because you're all here with enthusiasm, that I don't need to say much about Jeremy Bowen, but I will say that not only is he Middle East editor of the BBC, but I, for one, last year was checking to see whether he showed up at a particular moment in any of the revolts in order to know how serious it was.
Thank you very much. I suppose I could start with a case study if you want to look at the way that we covered the events of last year, and in fact the way that we continue to cover them, because what started last year is not was not a one-year process, and actually Arab Spring is a misnomer. I don't really like the phrase, because really what we're talking about is a moment of great historic change. The Arab world changing in a way, going to a whole new, all the old certainties are going or have gone. A new reality is gradually starting to emerge. No country in the region is immune. Even countries that appear to be safe, regimes that appear or might say that they may be safe from what's happening, they are not. And it's a long process. It might take 10 or 15 years even before a whole new shape emerges. And that's something which, of course, you know, in the when I say that to the people who write the diary at the BBC, you know, in terms of what we might be doing in the next week or two, and I say, well, it might take 10 years, it's not at all helpful. It's not what they, it's not at all what they want to know. But let me start, as I say, with a case study about how we got part of the story. And that was what, for me, was one of the highlights of last year, which was interviewing Colonel Gaddafi. It turned out to be the last interview he gave to the international media before, was the, his first of that particular time of trouble for Libya, and the last that he gave, for obvious reasons, because he then pretty much disappeared, and then he was killed. When Tripoli opened up in the end of February last year, opened up in the sense that they started granting visas, of course, everybody who turned up in the first wave of reporters and crews, producers who got in, wanted to get the interview with Colonel Gaddafi. We all asked. We all tried to manipulate whichever, you know, contacts that we had. The person who had the best contacts was Marie Colvin of the Sunday Times, who was killed, of course, in Homs a few weeks ago. We all asked the Libyans through various different channels. We had one particular channel going that we thought might be bearing fruit, but Marie had contacts that went back 15, 20 years. And in the end, they came to her and said, look, we know everyone wants an interview with Gaddafi. We're going to do one. We're going to give it to you, but we need TV. So what you need to do is nominate an international broadcaster and nominate an American broadcaster. Now, it so happens that Marie was a good friend of mine, and she's also a good friend of Christian Amanpour, who was working for ABC News. So that's why the Sunday Times, ABC News, and the BBC got the interview with Gaddafi. It was because Christiane and myself knew Marie well, and she nominated a couple of her friends to get the interviews. And she hopefully thought we'd do a good job as well. We did it collectively. Getting the interview itself, you know, like everything in Libya, it all ended, it was all very last minute when it actually happened. There was the man who we were dealing with, a guy called Sanusi, who is in fact the son of the intelligence chief who recently has been picked up in Mauritania. Gaddafi is one of Gaddafi's leading enforcers and a member of his family, too. And so what happened was that he suddenly came tearing down the corridor towards me and saying, it's happening, Jeremy, it's happening. We're going to do the interview with the leader. And TV being, you know, quite a waste-up medium, unless you have a shot, as John does in the studio, where you see his legs. So he has to... I was just doing live shots outside, so I had my quite nice jacket and shirt and pretty grotty pair of jeans. So I said to Sanusi, I said, you know, I think I should go and change. He thought, give me a minute. I've got a suit inside my room. I'll go inside. I'll change it. We're just outside my room in the corridor of the Rixos Hotel in Tripoli. And Sanusi was a bit of a fashion demon, as a matter of fact. He was a guy who was dressed for war and dressed as a commander almost, even though it was a five-star hotel with incredible bathing facilities. He always had a strong growth of beard, a kind of very beautiful designer combat jacket, a cashmere black commando hat on. And he looked at me and he said, no, no, Jeremy, it's war, jeans are fine. So we went, I thought we'd be heading to a place in the desert, a tent or something like that. But in fact, we went in two fantastic armored Mercedes to an Italian restaurant. And I was kind of, found myself stroking the extraordinarily beautiful interior suede roof of this wonderful armored Mercedes, and Sanusi turned around from the front seat, and he said, yeah, it's a James Bond car, isn't it? I said, yeah, my producer next to me, who put her bag of tricks into the boot, said, there's a rack of Kalashnikovs in the boot. So, you know, we went there and we did the, you know, like many things in journalism, in the end, it was a little bit random, the way that it happened. It happened unexpectedly. We all pushed for it. We got it through various means. And our coverage last year of the Arab Spring, I'll use that phrase even though I don't like it very much, started really in an equally random way. I remember having a conversation at the beginning of 2011 with my producer, and we were talking about what we might do in the next couple of months. And we had a list of things. I think top of the list was the question about the International Tribunal on Lebanon and whether or not they would be indicting members of Hezbollah. And then we said, and there have been these riots in Tunisia. And I said, yeah, I'm not sure they're really going to go anywhere, are they? You know, yeah, well, we'll keep an eye on them. And then after a few days later, I had an email from an academic at Oxford University, a Tunisian, in the Middle East Studies or Arabic Studies or something department. I've still got the email. And he said, why on earth at the BBC aren't you not doing something serious about what's happening in Tunisia? It is really very significant. I thought, blimey, you know, he's right, it hasn't stopped. Now, I couldn't then go, I thought, right, I'll go to Tunisia, but I couldn't because I was going to the War Crimes Tribunal in The Hague to testify against Radovan Karadzic from the stuff I was doing in Bosnia 20 years ago. And I didn't want to miss that. It had been 20 years in the making, after all. And so the fall of Ben Ali, I was watching from between hearings, from bits on TVs in The Hague. But other people, by then, we'd got onto it. But the point I'm making is we got onto it late, partly because we didn't see it coming, partly because it was Christmas beforehand. So, and the BBC, like many other broadcasters, pretty much shuts down at Christmas. So, you know, we were onto it late. You know, Bouazizi set himself on fire, what, I think it was the 17th of December. We probably had people out there by the first week of January. 3 weeks late? Yeah, definitely. My first dabbling in the events of the Arab Spring was the day after the police day disturbances and short occupation of Tahrir Square in Cairo, which was, though it happened, I think, on the 25th of January. Then I went out the next day. And frankly, I traveled on the Wednesday. It was a Wednesday. And I knew that they were planning a big demonstration for the Friday. And I thought to myself, I was quite skeptical about it. I thought, this isn't really going to go anywhere, because I'd been following Egypt quite closely. And I knew that there was quite a proud record of dissent and demonstrations. And I'd been on demonstrations in Cairo with members of people who considered themselves to be the opposition. And what normally happened was that people get knocked on the head and it would all be over. And in fact, I spoke to some of the organizers of those first demonstrations on Police Day on the 25th, and they said pretty much the same thing. One of them said to me, look, I had no idea it was going to go the way that it was. I thought that after 15 minutes, as usual, I'd be in the back of a police van getting a good kicking. And someone else who was involved in the planning of it all said, we started from a poor area because we thought we'd pick up more people on the streets. We were chanting slogans and they were hoping that they'd follow us. And people followed, but the streets were narrow, so we didn't know just how it was going to go. It was only when there was a certain road, there's a long boulevard in Cairo called the League of Arab States Street. And that's, she said, it was only when we got there, and I looked back and I thought, my God, there are 15,000 people behind me. That she said, only then did I know we had something. Only then. So I don't feel so bad about not knowing that it was starting. Of course, once Tunisia had happened, and then once the occupation started in Tahrir Square, and as I say, when I was traveling out there, I thought that on that Friday it would fizzle out. I thought there'd be a big fight, there might be some riots, it would fizzle out. Completely wrong. I thought that the hard edge of the police state in Egypt would be deployed, and they tried, and it came up short. Plus, of course, the army decided not to defend the regime in the way that they might have been expected to by some. But once Tahrir started, it was, of course, an incredible global media event and a massive, massive story. and almost a perfect story because it was over, what, after 17 days, I think it was, or something like that, just after 2 weeks, from the first occupation to Mubarak stepping down, which was, you know, in our global media universe of quite shortened imaginations and attention spans, was ample and incredible. And then everything else started happening. And it seemed like there was a domino effect going on, maybe a bit like 1989 in Europe. Well, it wasn't like that. And I will at this point claim that I did report at the time that this is not going to be easy and it's not going to be short. I think some of our news editor, some of our planning people in London, possibly concerned about their shrinking, rapidly being spent budgets, were hoping that it would all be over by the summer, that it really would be a spring of change. But I thought it became quite clear quite early on that it wasn't going to be like that. And there was a while at the end of, after Mubarak went, when there were big questions about where on earth do we go? Do we go to Libya starting, but how do we get into Libya? Do we go to Bahrain? What about Yemen? There are huge demonstrations in Yemen. And we've got to stay with Egypt because, of course, that's not over yet. And, you know, and so it goes on. In the end, actually, in terms of how we cover stories, one of the determinants, and again, it gets a bit random, is access. Egypt, we had access. You could turn up without a visa, get a visa at the airport, and go there. After Libya opened up, after they decided to let people into Tripoli, and then after the borders opened, and people could get in, first of all, from Egypt on one side, and then from Tunisia on the other without a visa, then Libya was open as well. But Bahrain was always quite hard to get into. Yemen was pretty much absolutely impossible. And Syria, when that started in March of last year, was also pretty much impossible. I felt strongly in terms of our coverage that while everything we did in Libya was very worthwhile, we couldn't do the things that we should have done in those other countries. I thought Syria was very significant from the beginning, as it clearly was, but getting in there was a big, big issue. Yemen, again, I thought Yemen was going to be one of the big stories of 2011 before the revolution started. And Yemen was very hard to get into. I speak to the people at the embassy here, who I knew quite well, and they say to me proudly, yes, we've dropped the president, Ali Abdullah Saleh. We've dropped him. We've defected, every one of us. I said, so will you issue me a visa? Oh, no, we can't do that. No, we need authority from Sana'a, or it's not going to work. But you've defected. I know, but we still can't stamp your passport. So it took me, and for Syria, I finally got a visa authorized in December of last year, which we used in January and February of this year. And I haven't had a visa since. And we also have teams who are going in illegally. I decided to try and keep myself pure and a little bit safer by trying to get the official visas rather than going in.
Can you find out, can we leave it at that at this moment?
Yeah,
and
sure.
Find out what people want you to say more about. Mm-hmm. I think, John, from your vantage point, these days not on the front lines of the war so much as trying to put together the story so that those of us watching Channel 4 News can understand what we should understand was going on in the Arab world. Have you reflected much on whether the story was coming out skewed, whether there was a lot of emphasis on this but not that?
Well, and the message to my Iraqi colleagues is salam alaikum. I'm delighted you're here. My perspective, obviously, is not quite as acute as either of my colleagues here because I spent less time on the ground. I was in Tahrir Square roughly the same time as Jeremy in that sort of first flush, and then I went back again a bit later. And actually being in the square was itself a perspective-forming experience because all my prejudices looked for all sorts of people who weren't there. That was a problem. I had assumed that it would be an essentially committed religious uprising, and it most certainly wasn't. Not at that stage. It was extraordinarily mixed. quite middle class, but also class mixed as well. I mean, but there were a lot of political activists who were secular, and there were lots of people I knew. I couldn't believe it. I mean, Egyptians that I hadn't seen in a very long time. Right in the middle of 100,000 people, I ran into Araf Souf, right in the middle of the square. I was completely lost, no idea where I was in the square, and there she was, and we had this wonderful sort of animated encounter, and she spent a great deal of time there. I also had an extraordinary experience with an actor, this English Arab actor, Egyptian origin actor, whose father is a gynecologist here in London. And at one point I had the gynecologist in the studio and the boy in Tahrir Square, this is when I got back, and I said to the boy, how's it going? And he gave us a wonderful account. And I turned to the father and I said, in your life, did you ever expect to see this? And he wept. And I've never had a man cry the way he cried that night. And he said, in my life, I never believed this could happen. And it was one of the most moving journalistic experiences that I've ever had. Because I had been on the ground with the boy, and here I was in the studio with the man, and the man was in tears, and the boy was effectively in flames. He was right to it. But I suppose the perspective that I have formed over this last year is that for all many of the reasons that you've spelled out, Jeremy, we didn't necessarily do terribly well. The fact is that although there was an Arab turning point, each of these protests was incredibly distinct and different from the other. And the temptation in London in particular was to try to roll them all into the same kind of event. And that actually what was happening in Libya was just what had happened in Egypt, but it wasn't. I mean, Libya was much more interfered with by external forces than was Egypt. Egypt was an Egyptian event, and outsiders could get stuffed. There was no outside involvement at all, as far as I could ever detect, and no interest in any outside involvement either. The Americans were completely polaxed. The Brits didn't know where to go. The French were on the ground. I mean, nobody knew the hell what to do from a Western perspective. And of course, they lost their boy. They lost Mubarak. And that really was a pain because it meant a lot of exports, jobs in Welwyn Garden City. There were all sorts of terrible issues at hand. This was a mess from an external point of view, but from an internal point of view, was exhilarating, intoxicating, and absolutely, as Jeremy has said, it may take 15 years, but it will be changed. It cannot be rolled back. It cannot, the cork cannot be put back on the bottle. It's over. But it's going to take an awful long time, and it's going to be painful, and it's going to probably be bloody, people are going to be resistant, because, of course, something exists in Egypt that we've never seen anywhere in the world, really, outside perhaps the old Soviet Union. And that is this extraordinary business of an economy which is dominated by the armed forces. And that's a very difficult thing to unwind. And that makes Egypt a very difficult problem. But of course, this temptation to turn all of these uprisings into the most accessible one, as Jeremy has said, Egypt was accessible. We could get in as tourists. We, unlike the BBC, could not take heavy equipment in because we didn't have a bureau there. They had heavy equipment there already. So all the early coverage...
We've always got our tanks ready.
For anybody other than the BBC, really, was on very, very small cameras. And it's extraordinarily good, considering. But they were tourist cameras. And if as long as you appeared at customs with nothing more than a tourist camera, although everybody knew what was going on, the Jobsworths at customs, who'd really already defected... knew that they were safe letting you in. But if you came in with a huge camera, they'd stop it. And that was to safeguard their own lives. It's what we didn't report in the course of reporting what was accessible. We didn't really ever look seriously, and nor could we, at the uprising in eastern Saudi Arabia, which was nasty, very brutally put down, a very, very upsetting and disturbing development. It resulted, obviously, in a huge buy-off of very large numbers of people in Saudi Arabia. There were huge handouts of new welfare benefits and the rest of it. There was a very quick response, but we never really managed to identify quite how much had happened. Human Rights Watch and people did a pretty good job, but it was very, very inaccessible. The Saudis were certainly not interested in any Westerners going in, and they're never very interested in any Westerners coming in of a journalistic nature anyway, unless they've been bought. And so I think the overall Saudi situation, and when Jeremy speaks, and indeed when Zahara speaks of what is still to come, I still believe down the road Saudi is still to come. And we shall look rather poor for not having got to the roots of whatever's going on.
They're tweeting from here, you know.
Bahrain, and I agree very strongly with Zahara here, Bahrain we covered very badly because we got people in, but it was very, very difficult to function. Brutal setup in terms of containing the press, and even more brutal in terms of trying to contain the uprising, which still to some extent is going on, despite the incredible repression that's been meted out on them. But we've never really had a full picture of it. We know the Crown Prince is a sort of reformist and the old boy is a bit more reluctant, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. But we've more or less left it there. And yet Bahrain has been part of our Western defense furniture for decades, but we're not very interested in what's happened. Yemen, agreed with Jeremy, impossible place to get into. Wonderfully uplifting to meet the Yemeni Nobel Prize winner, future president of the country, an amazing woman of 32, mother of four. God knows how she's done it, but she's there, and she is a very great hope if she lives. And if she lives, it will be thanks to the Nobel Prize, because she has a kind of aura around her now, which rather like Aung San Suu Kyi, protects her from the final curtain. I think she'll evade the kind of final curtain, as Aung San Suu Kyi has, but whether it'll take her as long as Aung San Suu Kyi, I don't know. I'm mindful that I've got to move on very quickly, but I did want to say that people also tried to get Syria into the Egyptian bottle, and that too has been a confusing thing to do, because it isn't. What I think one of the most interesting phrases to have come out of the whole Syrian debacle has been the concept that the Baathists are Shia. Now, the funny thing is, whenever you go to Syria, and I've been a bit, but not a huge amount, probably half a dozen times to report, and twice, I must say, on holiday, wonderful going to Aleppo at Easter and hear the crosses clanging around the streets with the old Maronites banging the bells and palms in the streets. It's an amazing experience. People don't know the half of what Syria is, the most gorgeous country, probably the best country in the Middle East, bar none, in terms of simply being a beautiful country and lovely people, but with this infernal situation that has been there within it for sort of 40 years, but possibly the only way to keep it going, who knows. But people have tried to compartmentalize it, tried to get it into a bottle that it doesn't fit into, and it is a very, very nasty, the nastiest situation of all the uprisings, and very, very difficult and very dangerous to cover. But I think the really untold story that we still have to grapple with is that there is a hot Shia Sunni war on. And that is the backdrop now to what is happening. That's what's been twisted out of the rebellion in Araby. The rebellion is now being contorted by those who wish to fight it out between the Sunnis and the Shia. Iran and the West has played an exasperating, what do I mean, an encouraging role, if you like, by fiddling about on the margins with Iran's nuclear situation, whatever it is or is not. And this is very dangerous. This is very dangerous. People had an interest in describing the Baathists as Shia. Anybody who's been to Syria, they may be a bad bunch. They may do some dreadful things. They may be very offensive. They may do this, that, and the other. But Shia, they never strike you as. They don't brass around the street saying, hello, boys, we're Shia. That's you. They're secular. And to many in the region, alarmingly secular. And so they don't fit into this jigsaw puzzle quite the way a lot of people want them to. And I'm worried that the West is blind to what's going on and blind to their role in exacerbating what's happening. It is a complete act of madness to believe you can deal with Iran on a one-track policy. There's plenty of stick and no carrot. The stick is, you know, you get rid of your nuclear aspirations and we'll be nice to you. You go to Tehran, you stand in Tehran, and you ask anybody in power who they're afraid of with a nuclear bomb. Is it Israel or is it America? It's neither. It's Wahhabi interfered with Pakistan. It is the idea that Wahhabi extremists will get hold of the nuclear missiles, and if they do, the first target will not be Jerusalem, it will be Tehran. And if we don't understand that, then we can't really begin to deal with the international furniture that surrounds this awful conflagration that is going on in Syria. Syria is partly about Iran. Syria is partly about Saudi Arabia. None of us know the extent to which either Qatar or Saudi are supporting the rebellion in Syria. We don't know what the nature of that support is. We know loosely that Qatari money is there. We're told that there are weapons there that have come in that way. We're in the area of darkness. We're where Marie Colvin died. We are at the front line of trying to understand what's going on in Syria, and we need to understand it. And if we don't understand it, then we play this wider game at our peril. The whole idea of thinking it's a great idea for Sunni Saudi Arabia and Shia Iran to go at each other, which is effectively, ultimately, what is going to happen, particularly now the playground of Iraq is now in full play, that way lies real disaster. I have one last tiny thing, and that is the biggest miss of this entire reportage, perhaps, has been Israel, because nobody bothered to cover, or very few people bothered to cover in any detail at all, the uprising in Israel, the uprising of people, tens and tens of thousands of people who had a gripe with the economic situation in Israel and the disparity of rich and poor within the country. At one point in Tel Aviv, there were 350,000 people on the streets. And damn me, they did not fit the reporting vernacular. They weren't on the streets talking about Palestinians, they weren't on the streets talking about peace, and they weren't on the streets talking about war. They were on the streets talking about the economy. And damn me, we'd never had to talk about the Israeli economy. Why should we start now, just because there are 300,000 people on the streets? This was a seminal development, and a very uncomfortable one for the Israeli leaders, and one with great implications if we don't take it on board. It may have dissipated for the moment, but there's an uncomfortable story there which we don't like to cover because it don't quite fit with our agenda. Thank you. And don't tweet that.
Too late.
Well, it could be, but I have to let you know that there is a very strong connection between what you just said and the Olive Tree program here at City University, because one of the main and most celebrated leaders of the demonstrations in Israel is an alumnus of City University Journalism School. And
I knew you were rebellion rousers.
Stav Shafir, she would like a debate with you, I think, whether it was only about economics. But we'll leave that for now.
Well, it was so badly reported, I don't know what it was about.
We'll ask Stav to send us a report.
Yes.
Now, it's going to be difficult to accommodate all the questions that must be out there. I'll take three at a time and I'll keep whizzing round. On this occasion, sadly, you can't treat us to your views. Just use the opportunity to find out something that you'd really like to find out from one of our three speakers and keep it short. Yeah, if you represent a news organization and you want to report what they've said, could you say so? We're on the record, but it would be handy. Yes, at the back there.
Hi, good evening. My name is Jayab. I'm one of the Olive Tree students. I graduated 2 years ago. I'm going to Syria in 4 weeks to report from there. What advice do you give me? I'm flying to Damascus. I'm not going through Beirut or Turkey.
Sub-question there. Jeremy mentioned that no country is immune. Is Saudi Arabia immune?
Okay. Should we answer?
You're saying, is Saudi Arabia immune? I see. Okay. Right, we've got those three, and we'll come to you in a second. So about Syria, about the Wahhabis, the Qatari foreign policy, and is Qatar immune to the Arab revolts? Who wants to start?
What?
Saudi.
Well, I can talk a bit about reporting from Syria because I've reported from Syria. I assume if you fly in, you don't have any visa issues. I would just get stuck in. I hope you have some local connections that would help you meet up with all walks of life there. But I certainly found when I was in Damascus on an official visa in January and February, I thought that it would be very restrictive as it was in Tripoli under Gaddafi, but it wasn't at all. And I don't know if that's because they wanted us to move around or whether they just hadn't quite organized themselves to stop us moving around. I felt I got pretty much a 360-degree view of what was going on. I got to places where the so-called Free Syria Army was in control. I got to Zabadani, which at the time was in the hands of the insurgents, and also suburbs of Damascus. Plus, I also talked to people in the regime. So it was actually, for me, it was a very fruitful trip. It was possible to get about, but, you know, okay, it's quite difficult, Zahra, and dangerous there.
Before we get on to the other subject, Zahra, what would you advise an Arab journalist about going to Syria?
Be careful.
Very careful. And I don't think anyone, I don't know, how are you going to get there? Are you going there as a journalist or as an Arab citizen who wants to visit Damascus? So are you actually announcing that you're a journalist? Because no journalist is allowed in. You're going there as a journalist. And
have you as a journalist? Oh, as an invite, okay. Oh.
That's fine, you will be okay.
No, you'll be okay, and I just think you just need to push it a little bit to get to where you need to be. Because if you're there on an official invitation, probably the worst thing they can do is kick you out. If you're there illegally, then they can do many worse things to you.
And does it make a difference what outlet you're reporting for?
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, it does. Yeah.
Okay, you might have to have another word with Dr. Harb. Shall we move to...
Can I just answer the question on religious broadcasting?
Okay.
I didn't follow religious broadcasting, to be honest. But Al Arabiya is privately owned by Saudi business people. And they have its relative relation with the Saudi royal family. And Al Arabiya they were actually reluctant to cover Tunisia. And then Egypt, they were really, like, Al Arabiya was far behind Al Jazeera in covering Egypt. And now it's following the Gulf countries' policy on covering Syria and also Yemen. They were basically at the back of, they were not, you know, their coverage was completely redundant in a sense that if you want to know what was happening, it wasn't Al Arabiya that will tell you what was happening. They're too much now into covering Syria as much as Al Jazeera through using, you know, user-generated content, basically using activist YouTubes, and they're completely concentrating on the opposition. So you don't get anything that has any relation to the regime on Al Arabiya. Again, the same thing on Al Jazeera Arabic now. And for instance, the demonstration that took place in Damascus a few days ago, or last week, I think, in support of the regime, those were reported on Al Arabiya as being structured, organized by the regime. So all these people has no actually kind of separate decision on their own. They were driven into these streets like sheep by the regime. So this kind of coverage that you get these days on Al Arabiya and, surprisingly, on Al Jazeera Arabic.
Do you want to say anything about Saudi Arabia being immune?
Yeah, I certainly. When I said no one's immune, I think what I mean by that is no one is immune from the climate of change. And you've already seen the Saudi king responding to demands for change in his country by trying to, as the Saudis often do, trying to buy it off, investing a huge amount of money and trying to increase the numbers of people who have a vested interest in the monarchy staying the way that it is there. I think that there is no immediate chance of, if people are after that, of some kind of rebellion in Saudi Arabia. But I do think that what has really changed in the whole region is the fact that people are no longer fully prepared to accept authoritarian government in the way that they were, that they are absolutely aware because of the pan-Arab television stations as well as social media, which I haven't talked about so much already so far this evening. They know that they don't actually have to live the way that they've lived. You can't seal a country off in the way that was once possible. And that's therefore why I think that these changes, that mood, has affected already all the countries of the region. And that's why I believe that even if it doesn't come to all-out rebellion, and one thing that we've seen over the last year is that the monarchies in the Arab world have dealt with the crisis in a different way to the way that the republics dealt with it. I think that even if it doesn't come to all-out rebellion, what we're seeing is a greater realization amongst monarchs that they have to move a bit towards the people. They can't just dictate in the way that perhaps they thought they could.
Okay. Do you want to tackle Qatari foreign policy?
Not tonight, I don't think. No. But if anybody can fill me in, I'm more than happy to listen.
I think the Qataris have reacted to a vacuum of leadership at the top of the Arab world. Egypt has turned it on itself because of the revolutionary process. Before that, Egypt was stagnant because of the way that Mubarak went. It had essentially voluntarily stepped back from its traditional position as a leader in the region. And the Qataris have got an awful lot of money. They've got quite a lot of ambitions. And they have parlayed this incredible gas fortune that they sit on top of into a position of extreme influence. Al Jazeera is a big part of that. It's an arm of Qatari foreign policy. And I think that they are trying to leverage their own position. It's a minute country. Hardly any native Qataris, really, compared to the size of a city like Cairo. Yet they have become very influential because they're using their money in quite a shrewd way.
Right, okay. One, two, three.
Hi, my name is Tara, I'm a journalist. I just had a question about in the way that you talk about the map of the region changing during the Arab protest, and given the fact that we had the Iranian revolution more than 30 years ago, which was in certain ways a similar revolution, overthrowing a monarchy with a bit of a Islamists on the side, which overtook the movement eventually. How do you see this dynamic? What is there to learn from that revolution and then from the Green Movement? And why is the discourse of the Green Movement fading away at a time when, as you said, it's good to point out that a lot of these people under these regimes are actually quite secular and they do not want their oppressive governments to represent them on the international community?
I think maybe it would be helpful if you all gave us perspectives too on the danger of talking to the most accessible people, not just going to the most accessible places, and whether we really get the strength of local feeling reflected in the most vocal voices. Nadia.
Thank you, Rosie. I am Dr. Nadia Chazli from Egypt. And I'll go back again to the Qatari question. This very tiny country, do you think it's acting for its own benefit or for its own interests, or is it a cat's paw? It's pouring money into Egypt to pay the Muslim Brotherhood, to pay the Salafis, and some allege that they're paying the counter-revolutionaries. So for whom is Qatar working? Who is the cat?
Qatar may have recognized an opportunity, but boy, are they stirring up some feelings. Yes, and where's the gentleman with the beard? Yes.
Thank you very much. My name is Bilal Ayasri. I'm doing my PhD on the Arab Spring in London. My question is to Zahira, and I'll be...
Zahira.
Zahira, sorry. I'll go to the question direct. As you will know, the Islamists are running the show in the Arab world now. Where is the Arab tsunami taking us? Thank you.
Secularists and Islamists.
Well, I mean...
And you're an expert on the situation in Iran.
I'm not. Well, I'm an Iranophile, I could call myself, if that's not an explosive identification. The Green Movement has been blessed with the worst possible allies in the West. There's no question. I mean, if you really want to destroy the Green Movement, the best thing you can possibly do is to rattle the sabers so considerably that you eventually bind even the most resentful haters of the regime into a resistance against the external threat. And that is what the West is working overtime to create, which is a very bizarre policy, really, to destroy kind of resistance inside the country, bind people together, even in this most disparate of political entities. It seems to me a very balmy sort of way of proceeding. Iran, you know, if anybody wants to bomb it, they should bomb it with laptops, because this is a bright, educated, engaged, westward-looking country. This is a country that looks west. However religious it may be, it looks west. And the failure by the United States to get over the hostage crisis, which I was on the ground for, it was grotesquely mishandled at the time by the Americans, by the international community. It could have been resolved much easier. It was resolved by the very people who offered to resolve it in the first place, who were the Algerians. And on the last day of the 444-day siege, hostage crisis, it was the Algerians who, in fact, sorted it out. But be that as it may, it is genuinely time for Obama's open hand of friendship to be followed by a wrist, an elbow, a shoulder, and a body. Nothing followed the open hand. Nothing. Now, what is required if Iran is going to be engaged, and it needs to be engaged, certainly you people in the room next door from Iraq, you will know that the international community not engaging Iran makes the management of Iraq exceptionally difficult. Iran needs to be engaged. That hand needed to be followed either by Hillary Clinton on the ground herself within a day or two of that statement being made. I mean, okay, a week or two. Or by Obama himself. But my hope for the second Obama term, if it occurs, is that Iran will be one of the breakthrough areas. Iran will be Obama's China, because it's a country with sensational potential. The leadership is atrophied. It has disintegrated largely. It's at war with itself. It's eating itself. The Revolutionary Guard is split. The president hates the supreme leader. The supreme leader hates the president. The Majlis is split. Every aspect of leadership in Iran is completely up the Khyber, even though the Khyber is a long way from Iran. I think there's a golden opportunity for the West to engage, and we're going in precisely the opposite direction. I've never been in Saudi Arabia. I make no bones about it. It's one of the few countries in the region I've not been to. It's not an easy country to go to. But my sense is that we could make much more headway with change in Iran, that is organic change that comes from the people themselves, than ever one could in Saudi Arabia. And Saudi Arabia, I agree, will be a very, very, very slow process before anything happens. But it will happen. Something will happen eventually.
Okay. Now, in the reporting, do you feel this pull to take sides between secularists and Islamists, if you like? Are you constantly being asked this question? Should we be afraid that Qatari money, Saudi money, somebody's money is fueling this phenomenal Islamist menace, and that it'll all go sour and rotten in the end?
Well, as you know, in the BBC, we're not allowed to take sides. We're impartial at all times. I'd like to make that absolutely clear.
And we share that.
Yeah, and Channel 4 News equally.
We are regulated, and thank God for that.
Yeah, we are. We're not Fox or anything like that, either of
Look
us.
Look what happens when you're not regulated.
Yeah. Firm-handed regulations, good on things like partiality. I was interested in what you were saying about talking to accessible people rather than... I mean, how do you select interviewees? In Tahrir Square, people who were there, and there was a whole cross-section of Egyptian society there, people got so intoxicated by the fact that they could talk to people like ourselves without being arrested that actually became quite wearing. You'd walk with a television camera just even a few yards, and people would be coming up and saying, could I make my statement? Could I do my interview now? I'm ready for my close-up. No, it wasn't, we've done... we'd stop for a rest after a hard 5 hours of filming and interviewing people. People would come up and say, why aren't you filming? What's going on? I've been filming it for all day, thank you very much. We're just stopping for a cup of tea now, if that's all right with you. So people were very, very anxious to do it. But then how do you select it? And the fact is that even if you factor out the language issues, which are important because our viewers speak English and prefer to listen to people who are speaking to them in a language that they understand rather than it being voiced over or even subtitled, which we don't do on news programs anyway. So even if you deliberately say, we're not going to go for any English speakers at all, then there's another issue, which is in the way that our pieces are constructed, say a news report, and the pieces I was doing, again from Egypt, but you can take other examples, they were quite long by the standards of daily television news. You know, I'd be doing between 3 and 4 minutes, which is pretty meaty piece for, say, the 10 o'clock news, very meaty. And you can get quite a lot into that much. But the point is, the way it's structured, you want to get a good clip out of people. You need people who are going to speak to you and come up with something coherent in about 20 seconds max, 15, probably is about, maybe even a bit less. So what does that mean? It means that you sometimes find yourself picking people who probably think in the way that you're thinking. And that tends to be people who probably who are well-educated. They're not just people who've come there and they're full of passion, because you talk to someone who's not well-educated, and there are, in Egypt, as an example, something in the high 30s% are illiterate.
40%.
There you go. That's the updated figure. 40% illiterate. So that means, they're not educated. But clearly, their participation in the events was very significant. But when you ask them a question, they might start shouting and ranting, and some of their friends come in, and they start pumping the air or punching the air, and they start giving you slogans and... or making speeches. And yes, you can get a feel for that, but you can't necessarily tell the story very well with that. So inevitably, you tend to then find someone who, even if they're not speaking English, will be able to speak to you in that kind of thought-out way that you might be after. Does that give the wrong kind of impression about what was happening? Perhaps it does.
But I think the pressure's the other way. I mean, what people start saying from London, they say, go and find us some of these Muslim Brotherhood. They sound really dangerous. You know, they used to kill people in large numbers in the 50s. Try and find some of these people and find people who want to impose Sharia law. Scare the pants off us.
The people in the tent, they kept saying to me, when are you going to do the Muslim Brotherhood story?
Yeah.
I said, well, they're not that. We did stuff on the Muslim Brotherhood, and the Muslim Brotherhood have spokespeople you can speak to. I mean, they're very accessible.
But I think the true answer to your question, which was a very good question, and indeed was yours, because they're both in the same mold, is that organic change, once it starts taking place, is very, very difficult to stop. And the Iranians have found that. And the fact is, actually, they've reached all sorts of extraordinary accommodations. After all, you can go to North Tehran and find a Parisian arrondissement of about 2 million people who are wealthy beyond anything you've ever... You walk in, there's a Picasso, there's rum in the corner. I mean, there has been an accommodation. But there are the seeds all the time of ferment and change. And the idea that there's something special about an Islamist government that is going to do something that no secular government has ever managed, not even a Soviet government, and that is survive forever. and dominate and be naughty and dreadful is crazy. I mean, it will be a phase. And people may need to go through a phase of having a religious government to find out what it's like and see whether it's what they want.
Yeah, but also I think that we need to be aware that the people of Egypt has actually occupied the streets for some time, saying that we want to regain our revolution. And that was made on a secular basis. And the same thing is happening now in Tunis, in Tunisia. Yesterday, there was a huge demonstration in Bourqiba Street, and the slogans were actually saying that we want a secular state, we don't want a religious state. So I would say, as many of the people in the Arab world are saying, we're not afraid of the future of Egypt and Tunisia, because it was an organic movement from within, and they will actually keep protesting, in a sense that there is a debate is taking place now. People are able to speak out. So you can't oppress people who have the means to, you know, express what they want.
Okay. I'm really sorry. I don't think I'm going to survive when I get out the room, because there's so many people who are going to be disappointed.
We didn't answer the Kashi question.
Let's leave Qatar, because it's a book of its own.
Yeah. We've got two people holding the microphone at this minute. Can they ask their question, please? The one at the top there, and the one down here.
Thank you for your invaluable insights. I wanted to ask, you all seem to believe that the coverage of the Arab Spring has been really skewed. But perhaps has the increased attention towards the Arab region been beneficial in promoting interest or deeper understanding of Arab politics or society?
Well, sitting for the majority of it in London myself, I think it has. I think people in Britain are genuinely interested in the Arab world. They're rather shocked to find out what we were doing there. They're rather shocked to find who we were propping up, what business we were doing. It was some of the most odious people who have stalked about on the Earth's surface for a very long time.
And let's have Roger. Unfortunately, he's another professional.
Apologies.
Very quickly, Roger.
I was with the World Service for more than 20 years as a Middle East analyst. But to me, the biggest single weakness, and I think you've touched on it, but I think it is huge, is the lack of staying power. We get our audience is interested in Tunisia, and we drop Tunisia. When was the last time either of your teams covered Tunisia? The election? I'd be surprised if it was more recently. We cover Libya when there's a war. We cover the bang bang. We cover what is deemed in media jargon to be sexy. We excite an interest, a very good and important interest on the part of audiences in these countries, but we don't sustain it. And I think money and budgets, while an important part of the answer, are not the whole answer.
That's a good way for you to each have 1.5 minutes to offer your final thoughts to this incredibly interested audience. Zahra, you go first.
Oh. I was actually discussing the same issue with my students last week about the fact that Western media is, you know, was interested in covering when the revolutions was taking place, but then afterwards we lost interest in what's happening in, and I think part of it, Jeremy was talking about budget, but you know, if the Western audience is going to know what's happening in the Arab world, they have to keep foot in these countries, and they have to actually report on what's happening after the revolutions and not just during the revolutions. And the quick answer to your comment is what happened in the Arab world, mainly what happened in Tunisia and in Egypt, did not just shock the Western world, it shocked us in the Arab world. I'm one of the people who were completely taken by surprise that Egyptians, you know, we were all feeling proud, and for the first time in what happened in Tunis and in Egypt made us all feel that we want this, you know, we all felt this sentiments of Arab, pan-Arabism again, actually, you know, going into the Arab world. And we all felt proud for the first time in a long time being an Arab because of what the Tunisians and the Egyptians did.
Yes, I think that people are more interested in what's going on in the region as a result of what's happening. Your comment, Roger, there's a lot in that. Sustaining a story is really difficult sometimes. keeping the interest. Our surveys constantly say that, that the audiences are not happy when we have blanket coverage of something, then we drop it like a hot potato. And yet we still never quite learn properly from that. That's partly because in terms of daily news, and the you know, if I was an official BBC spokesman, what I'd say is we do continue to cover all of this, but on different outlets. But on the major outlets, we often don't, because if things don't have a sharp enough top line, they don't force their way in. I would say in defense of the corporation, which I've worked for 30, almost 30 happy years, we still have, for example, a full TV team in Libya. We haven't not had one since it all started. We still have a producer, cameraman, reporter there, plus radio people. But it's a question of getting it on the air. And it is a problem with the medium of television news, of trying to get things on when they're not dramatic. For me, it's a constant issue, because I do try to get things on where they're not dramatic, but sometimes it's a struggle. So what you need to do, what we generally do, is work up to an event and try and do something around that. And let's make no bones about it. Sometimes it's no longer a daily story in the way that it was. I mean, I think in general, what we've learned from the last year is that, as I said at the outset, there is something very significant going on there. I certainly think that news organizations, Western media organizations, which I know best, worth their salt, will continue to try to cover it quite extensively. But it is something that, you know, we cover other stuff as well. So while I push the whole time for the Middle East to be on the whole time, we don't always succeed in doing it. And sometimes it's not. And on that one thing about Qatar, I don't know the answer to whose cat's paw, who's pulling the strings with Qatar. You know, I was always taught at university that states act in their own interests. And so therefore, they're acting in their own interests, but they're very small countries. So it's one of the enigmas of the region. Certainly.
These days, we also keep asking, what is the media narrative?
Well, Roger has ensured that we end on a completely uplifting note, because the fact is, it is being covered, and it's being covered very, very well. The fact is, we are entering the golden age of journalism, and the golden age of journalism is dawning in a multi-platform form. And the fact is, if you want to find out even what's going on in Yemen, you can find it. You may not know the people from whom you're trying to extract information initially, and it takes time to determine whether the people you're reading are people you want to read or not. But the fact is, we are getting to material that we never had the opportunity to reach before. And now it is up to us in the mainstream to whet the appetite, but to expect us to sustain it whilst ideological struggles are going on in cafes in Tunis as to whether you want a secular or Islamic state, I beg you not to inflict that on a Wigan audience. The fact is, you've got to keep the mainstream with you. And the idea that you can keep the thing running with the intricacies of what's happening here and there, of course there will be people who will want to know about the ideological struggle, but it will be furnished by other people. And this is where the citizen journalist is going to have such a fantastic way. When you are there in Damascus, you'll be able to blog, you'll be able to tweet, you'll be able to reach all sorts of people that when I started, I had no chance of reaching. We have moved from a point at which I could go with one camera that was on film and send things in 5 days after they happened on a flight in the hope they don't get lost in Heathrow customs, and it will eventually get on air, and it will be a beautiful little report about something that happened in Syria. Today, there is some opportunity to know every single minute of every day. I knew about a bombardment in the suburbs of Syria within 3 minutes of it happening today, not courtesy of the BBC, not courtesy of Al Jazeera, but courtesy of people that I follow on Twitter in Syria. Thank you very much. That's the future. And although you may think it's a naked future, because we don't know who these people are, they may be tweeting crap and all the rest of it, the fact of the matter is, if you follow the right people, if you determine where your tracks lie, you have every chance of arriving at a much more brilliant destination than we've ever known before.
And he's going to end on a note which is going to make you all clap. Just let me just say thank you ever so much for sparing us so much of your precious time. without the media to just talk. It's a privilege for us. So thank you all three very much indeed.
Well, thank you for arranging.
There's a whole lot on Twitter from the people in the room here.